In our society today, we are all susceptible to the influences of the media. We make no apologies for talking once again to someone who, at the same time as criticising the media, is also able to manipulate it. Last week, I talked to someone who many people consider to be the lady next door, everybody's favourite auntie, Mrs. Mary Whitehouse. But is this a true image any longer? Do ordinary people have this power that Mrs. Whitehouse now has? She, as an example, has immediate access to everyone in a position of power in our society today. Mrs. Whitehouse, that's true.
I wouldn't have thought so. I don't know who these people are that I have immediate access to.
You know that you can come in and telephone any newspaper, any MP, any television company, and that the name, if you just say Mrs. Mary Whitehouse on the telephone, they will talk to you, they will listen to you. Is that not true?
To some extent that's true, but I want to say this. I don't think that I have now any power, and I wouldn't want to have any power, that everybody else doesn't have. I think that all that I am doing on behalf of our association is to exercise a democratic right, which we have in this country, for people who feel keenly about any particular aspect of our life to up and say so.
Nevertheless, the fact is that Mrs. Smith at home, who happens, let's say, to disagree with you, has not herself got the same
look,
power.
Look, let's get all this in perspective. When we began 9 years ago, my friend and I were two very ordinary Mrs. Smiths, and we started to speak out on this matter, and we only have the position we now have because we've continued to do so. So I don't think it's right to put us in any special position at all.
Now, how many people do you consider you represent?
Well, as far as the association itself is concerned, we have between 12 and 13,000 memberships.
That's subscribing members.
These are memberships, not members, because many of these represent block memberships of organisations, churches, what have you.
How many would that represent? Some,
between 2 and 3 million. But now I want to say, in addition to that, I'm really not in any doubt at all, because of the way I travel up and down the country and speak to every type of group, that the vast majority in the people in the country do share a concern about what's happening, particularly to the young, and about standards and the quality of life that comes through our television
programme. But do you feel also that after all, there are something like 30 million television viewers, that there are very many more people who may not, and they are not organised at this moment. I'm not saying whether it's their fault or not. The fact is they're not organised. They're not going to be able to phone MPs other than individuals, journalists other than individuals.
No, I don't honestly think you can assume this at all. If these people existed in the kind of strength and numbers that you believe they exist, I can't conceive that they wouldn't have organised and spoken out.
Do you not feel that tolerance, you know, that the kind of people who are rather tolerant and, let's say, even if you're talking about sex at all, rather happy in their sex lives and so on, are not going to be impelled to protest?
Oh, but I think it depends what you think we're talking about. You talk about people who are happy in their sex life. So am I, and I've always been. You mustn't assume that because we speak out on these issues that we're a group of people who aren't happy about our sex life. It's actually because we believe that sex is so important and that we feel that the present obsession with sex, I mean, we don't start this. We are reacting to an obsession with sex in society through the mass media, through advertising, everywhere you look. And it's because we want the young not to be pressurised and not to be exploited in this field, so that they can grow up to develop their own sexuality, to discover for themselves what sex as part of the whole business of living is all about, that we do what we do. And quite honestly, on the matter of numbers, there have been, during the course of the last 9 years since we started, a number of people who have tried to organise what you might call opposition groups to what we do, but they've never got off the ground.
You don't think that's anything to do with the fact that they don't actually have the strong feeling that things should be changed, that things should be stopped, that they actually believe that television is all right the way it is?
All my experience, and if I may say this, I think probably we are in rather a unique way position to judge this, simply because we do have you know, speak at so many meetings of every kind, up and down the country, to hundreds of people every time, that the concern that we have is shared by the vast majority of people. That I believe absolutely to be true.
And yet, I mean, if you work in television at all, if you work in newspapers, you get hundreds of letters from people saying, in effect, who does she think she is? Why do I have to believe that these programmes
should not go on? Well, I mean, I wonder how
on.
True this is. You yourself were taking part in a television programme last Sunday, and the reaction that had come in from the public was that the proposition that the permissive society was
a danger.
Dangerous had 55% of the people who had written in believe that to be true, and I think only 20% of them supported your position.
You don't feel that that has anything to do with the fact that people who are insecure, who are worried and doubtful and not in a position of some kind of happiness, if you like, cannot really respond?
Not at all. It is the people who are so aware of how happy and exciting and stimulating life can be. These are the people who are so concerned at the image of life which is being presented to so many of the young people. I don't think you've got it right, if I may say so.
Well, now, you were talking a little while ago about the Dennis Potter play that was on television last week.
Yes.
Now, I was truly astonished to hear you say that you thought that this was something like 90% worse than the Warhol film, which none of us have seen.
What I said actually was that although we haven't seen the Warhol film, what the judges said, that this was 10% offensive and indecent.
Yes.
I would certainly say that that play, the Potter play, was 90% offensive and indecent.
In what way?
Well, I thought the whole concept in the first place was very sick indeed.
The concept? I mean, this was a man who was dictating a play of his to a secretary.
Yeah.
I'm not talking about dictating a play to a secretary.
No. I'm talking about the whole concept of the play itself, of the characterisation, of the whole sexuality of the people in the play. I mean, they were all in one way or another sick. But the thing that I think people would find very offensive indeed would be the language.
Now, that's very interesting, because what language did they use?
Well, if you're asking me to repeat
on television, they said bitch. I remember him saying bitch quite frequently.
But if you remember that play, the whole level of the discussion of sexuality was on, to put it mildly, on an exceedingly coarse level indeed.
What is coarse?
People must just... I would suspect that most of the people who are watching this programme know very well what coarse language is.
I don't think
we have to identify.
I would have thought we do have to, because...
Really?
A couple of weeks ago, on open night, there were children talking about television. Mm. Now, one of the subjects they were talking about was swearing on television. And one of the things they brought up was, well, what were your own feelings about the till death do us part?
No, you weren't participating.
But they were bringing it up.
Yeah.
And they asked the children if they thought that this was bad, and they said, no, they'd heard all this before, and they asked, have you heard more than this, what you would call dirty language, outside the television screen? And the boys, three of them, I think, said, absolutely, of course we have.
What does this prove?
It proves only that life is different.
Yes, but this is really what one's... the whole of what one's concerned about. If you believe, as I certainly believe, and I believe that people who work in television believe it too, that television is the most powerful medium. In fact, the BBC says this, the most powerful medium ever to affect the thinking and behaviour of people.
And yet it does not say words that the children in ordinary families know.
But why are children today knowing words of this kind and having this level of language? You see, now, can I make this point, because I think it's tremendously important. It doesn't really matter what four letters make up one particular word. This isn't what we're talking about. What we're talking about is the level of our culture and of our communication. And one of the things that is now happening, which once again I think is so... this in a way is sick and rather frightening, is that instead of helping the young... and I was responsible for sex education, so I understand a little bit about this, to learn more mature ways of expressing sexual matters and sexual interest, What is happening now is that adults are putting a seal of respectability on a sort of four-letter word syndrome, which adolescent boys have always written on lavatory walls. In other words, instead of helping the young to mature and develop in their communication, we're suddenly saying to them, oh no, we won't help you to grow up. We will go back and join you in your adolescent culture.
But what can be actually damaging, actually harmful to children about words?
Oh, goodness me, you say, what? I don't understand that question. Words are the means by which we express ourselves, by which to a great extent, our culture is judged. And you see, I think we have to help the young to grow through the sort of rebellious crudities of adolescence and find more subtle, more beautiful, more tender ways of expressing what they feel.
But is there any harm, any active harm
certainly,
in certain words?
Because it's the degradation of your culture. It's the degradation of the whole quality of the way you communicate with one another and the way you live. I think this is a very harmful thing.
You don't think it's better for them to be able to... I mean, I have noticed one thing myself, and that is that the words that I remember in my youth being written up in railway carriages on walls and so on are not written up anymore because... They are
well,
now
what's
acceptable.
Written up in their place?
Therefore, they are nothing.
Really?
No, nothing.
Well, you must
they are simply not existing anymore. Because given the seal of approval by adults, in a sense, if that's what we're doing, we are saying they are not as dirty as you thought they were, therefore you don't have to worry.
No,
Rebellion is not necessary in those ways anymore.
No. In a way, the young have to have something to rebel against. See, I have no evidence, psychological evidence, to know how sound my theory about this is, but I just ask myself, if you remove from adolescents the words with which they rebel against mature people in their society, and you make their rebellious words acceptable.
Mm.
Where then do the young go to rebel?
Perhaps because they don't need to.
Oh, they must rebel. I mean, this is all part of growing up. The young must rebel at some particular point against the ideas and that have been passed down to them. They must question
But you are trying to stop them.
No, I'm not.
Actually
You've got
trying
not
to rebel.
At all. No, not at all. What I'm saying is this, that it's essential that the young at some point question the values that have been handed down to them.